So we're going to be talking about the future of artificial reality. I'm Sophia Dominguez. I'm the founder of All Things VR, which is a virtual reality newsletter. You guys should also subscribe. It comes out every Tuesdays. And also the co-founder of Surf, which is going to be a search engine for virtual reality content. We're just going to go ahead and allow everyone to introduce themselves. Everyone has been involved in the virtual reality and augmented reality industry for quite some time. So we're very privileged to have everyone here. Start with you, Ken.
That's Surf with a V. I'm Ken Perlin. I'm a professor of computer science at NYU, and our group studies future reality.
I'm Omer. I'm currently working as a VR artist at NVIDIA. I was trained as a mathematician, but I always made films, and coincidentally, I was a researcher at Ken Perlin's lab for a bit, then continued to make VR.
You were trained as a mathematician? Wow. I am not a mathematician. My name is Alexander Ray. I am the head of creative technology at Framestore. Framestore is a VFX post house. And it's awesome to be here. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Phil Chacko. I'm founder of Featherfab. Our mission is to make it easy for anyone to be able to design physical objects, and we're doing that by building a 3D design tool for VR with a sharing community on top of it. So you'll be able to design things and 3D print and share your ideas with other folks.
I'm Tony Mugavero. I'm the founder and the CEO of a company called Littlstar. We're a premium network for immersive content, 360-degree video in virtual reality. We have channels on the platform like ABC, Showtime, Nat Geo, Discovery, pretty big networks and publishers. You can download our apps on iPhone, Android. They work with Cardboard. We're also available in VR headsets. We have a developer platform as well, so some pretty big publishers building on top of us like USA Today VR, Discovery VR, Hearst, all built on top of Littlstar. So check us out.
Awesome. So we wanted to do something a little different with this panel because all of us are really bored about talking about the current state of virtual reality and augmented reality. And if you're here, you probably follow it in some sort of way, so you know that there's a difference between mobile virtual reality and high-end virtual reality. So we're going to talk about the future of virtual reality and augmented reality for like 5, 10, 15 years out and not focus on anything that's happening today because we're bored of that. So we're going to define the definitions of virtual reality. Virtual reality is a computer-generated 3D image or environment that can be interacted with in a real or physical way. So think about this world as it's internal, right? And for augmented reality, technology that superimposes computer-generated images on a user's view of the real world, and think of this as external. And for the purposes of this panel, we're not going to be speaking about mixed reality. Mixed reality, just think of it as augmented reality, because otherwise it'll get confusing. And artificial reality is the blending of virtual reality and augmented reality. So with that in mind, let's get started. The first question that I would like to pose to the panelists is AR and VR going to be in one device? And if so, what does that look like in 5, 10, and 15 years?
Yes, it will be in one device.
Okay. And what does it look like?
It will look like the normal glasses that you wear, or it will look like contact lenses, and it will need to look great. I mean, we saw what happened with Google Glass, and people, it just looks kind of weird walking around, and when you have enough power built into a sexy package, you know, people want to look good when they're walking around with technology on their face. And mm-hmm. So if you look weird, you know, there's a real human condition there with having a problem with that. So it's going to naturally trend to a really small, clean, beautiful package that is really powerful.
Can everybody hear us, by the way? Raise your hand if you can't hear us. Okay.
One person.
All I hear is that keyboard thing from downstairs.
Yeah, totally. It's like there's music going on. So I have a different view on that. I think that if we're treating AR as in like sensory augmentation of our reality, we are already augmented in like all sorts of ways. You know, like some of us have Apple Watches. If we treat like AR in the sense that like we are currently getting based on our location or our position in the world, you know, like our actions, we're getting some kind of electronic feedback. Like we're already there. So the question really is, What's the best way to do that, like in a way that, that comes naturally and does not feel intrusive like Tony wants? And I think that, VR has it really easy, right? Like, you know, you just put glasses, those glasses will become smaller, they'll obscure our eyes, even if it's not with something opaque, eventually it will be something with, I don't know, like liquid crystal shutters that are really strong will obscure our eyes. But AR, even in the far future, has a much harder problem to deal with than VR. And if you're thinking about, like, all the purposes that you use VR for, the headset is pretty good for most of them, as far as I can tell. In AR, I don't think that's the case. You know, like, you want to do many, many different things that involve your current reality. Like, I want to be able to navigate with my car. I want to be able to, and this is a real product, I want to be able to I want to be able to see the path that I'm drilling in, if I'm using a drill, or like, you know, like a, what's it called? Like the mill? You know what I'm talking about?
Jigsaw.
Like,
a drill.
It's a mounted drill.
A router.
Router. Thank you. So you know, you can see that on top, and those are different things, and they solve optically different problems. I don't necessarily see them being on glasses in the long run, but if we are talking about like head-mounted displays that will intrude into your eyes, then they'll probably end up in the same place.
Okay. It's on? Good? Yes? I agree with the first answer, with a possible caveat that there'll probably be a transition. Well, there'll be some brick in our pocket, but we'll just carry that around for some extra firepower until Moore's law says we don't need it anymore. I also think that if we're talking about 5, 10, 15 years, eventually, assuming the computers keep getting exponentially better and we don't change, The VR and AR will just end up converging. You know, when you get to the point where you have the contact lenses, you'll just mix real and virtual. I mean, we already mix real and virtual now. You know, when you read a book or you look at your computer screen, you're looking at something virtual, but you're not thinking about it because you've done it all your life. So I think when kids start growing up in a world where the real and the virtual just gets mixed indiscriminately, that will just be normal reality. Like today's highly, highly mediated world that we live in is also just to us normal reality.
I have a comment. Who here has played Pokemon Go?
Pokemon okay. What?
See, there we are. That's about as advanced as I think we can get in the near future with AR. And that you saw what kind of adoption that was. It was simple. It was great. It was fast. It was right there in your face. And it was a success. Whether or not it's a success for the company that makes it, who knows? But I think the advancement and Moore's law and all that other stuff is great, but the humans advance and human behavior, I think, advances a lot slower than, and human adoption of technology advances a lot slower than where the technology actually is. And I think that, just personally, that we, even 5 years away from now, there's still going to be headsets that are connected to a gaming box or a high-end PC, and then there's going to be the experiences that are on the mobile phone. And there's going to be thought leaders and folks like us that are on the bleeding edge of everything. Great, but from a mass adoption standpoint, and that's where my head tends to be, is always thinking about mass adoption, I think there's going to be a divide even 5 years from now. It's hard for me to look past 5 years, but I think that the everyone walking around with a headset or your contact lenses is more of a behavior problem. I think humans are not going to be able to adapt to that as quickly as we would like, in my opinion. I think humans are a little slower to adopt in mass than we would like them to be.
I'll disagree. So I think I think humans adopt new technologies pretty fast when they're good. So Pokemon Go got to Twitter scale in 5 days flat. That's pretty impressive. Impressive that it worked, that the app worked at all with that many people on it. So when things are good, people will use them. But I think the right question, I think a lot of us think is relatively obvious that AR and VR will converge eventually. But the tricky question is when. That's a hard question. And so if you're trying to map out when that happens, I don't think that'll happen in 5 years. I'll say, you know, probably not even in 10.
Why don't you think it will happen in 10?
So 10, I think, is I'll say there's a 40% chance it happens in 10 years. I'll hedge. Because for AR to work really well, to get to a pair of glasses, we need to have... Today, a high-end VR experience requires a gaming rig, a thing that you're tethered to, a really powerful GPU. For that to get miniaturized and for our computer vision algorithms to catch up is going to take time. And you know, to get so to within 10 years is somewhat dicey for those businesses.
Omer can speak like better to this, but essentially graphics cards have evolved in, like, now they're changing every single 3 months and getting more and more powerful. And so assuming that, then the size, you know, will decrease. And so by 5 years from now, then they'll probably fit in our smartphones, which means that screens will be incredibly great. And so then VR and AR takes on a whole new evolution. I mean, Omer works at NVIDIA, so he can talk more about that.
I can't speak for my company. I'm here for... Oh, never mind. So
it's a great company.
Thank you. I made it. The thing is, it's not just about rendering that makes it difficult, to push pixels into your face. Also, if you only look at what needs to be achieved to put lots of pixels into people's faces in order to reach the order of magnitude that we're looking for to make believable reality, we're talking about things that cannot, like, conceivably fit on a GPU even within several generations. We're talking about 24K by 24K. That was the assumption made by Michael Abrash a few years ago about, like, you know, the good resolution you need a display to be in order to do that. And that has multiple things going on for it that are all that all require re-engineering the entire system. For one, you know, even our visual cortex cannot process that amount of information, so we need to come up with ways to compress that. And, like, lots of companies, but NVIDIA is one of them, are working on ways to do foveated rendering, which is essentially rendering only around the part of your eye in which you're looking at a space. And that really helps. But you also need to come up with ways to minimize the size of display that you're looking at, because, like, creating 24,000 pixels by 24,000 pixels, that's a lot. Like, you cannot make such a display that small in current generation technologies. I can't guarantee about future generation technologies, but I'm the consensus pretty much nowadays is that this may not be, for the short run, the way to go. But there are different problems. Like, you know, the one really significant problem that you have with VR is input. If you have, like, currently, you know, you are trying to put your hand in the real world, encoding the real hand, and Ken can speak for it because, like, his lab does a lot of that. Encoding the real hand and presenting it and capturing the exact pose and then transforming it to a game engine space or something that can be digitally used is still a hard problem. If anyone has played with HoloLens, they'll see that they have this motion because this is pretty reliable now. It also causes fatigue. So, you can't use it for long. It's not like they're making good efforts. That's not to say, seriously, they have advanced a lot, but this is not at where it should be currently. There's still some generations across. And I think that's why, like, you know, when you talk about, like, graphics cards being better, there's more amounts of research that needs to happen around graphics cards to make this happen.
Who out there has played with HoloLens yet? Does anyone have the opportunity? Oh, fantastic. I was expecting less hands in that. That's awesome. And what about Magic Leap? Anyone play with that yet?
Damn.
Oh, very interesting. I like to know who you people are. Like, that's a great product, but very, very far in from actual commercial available product you could buy in the store.
Yeah.
But I think that one of the great things where the space we're in right now is there are these headsets that are now on the market, as we know, people are using them downstairs, we can buy them now. I'm very curious, after this coming holiday season, what the sales are going to be like on these units, because if there's not a lot of sales on these units, eventually these companies might phase out these products, because we're in that window right now where it's like, great, everyone is like, oh my God, this is awesome, VR headsets are everywhere, Vive, Oculus, but if they don't sell this holiday season or the holiday season after that, those companies will have a problem keeping themselves open. those are the realities, right? There has to be impact at a mass scale.
I disagree. Facebook has like unlimited amounts of cash.
But they're not a stupid company, though.
Yeah, but they're going to continue pushing forward like virtual reality and augmented reality because they know that this is the future and this is going to happen and they're going to innovate on top of it. And so, yes, maybe Oculus doesn't have the Rift anymore, but they're going to have something else. And so HTC Vive might not have the Vive anymore, but maybe something else comes of it. But like more people innovate on top of these hardware because like this is the future and we all know that this is the future and that's why we're all in this industry. So it doesn't matter if like one device fails or the other device succeeds, because at the end of the day, like all of these companies are in it for the long haul and some will fail and some will succeed.
I vote for sticking with the theme. Sophia asked about 5, 10, 15 years in the future. So yeah. Let's not talk about 2017.
Woo.
Okay.
Going back to the future, what I want to talk about, what do you think it'll feel like to switch in between virtual reality and augmented reality? So, I mean, in terms of using Skype, right? So what's the future of Skype? You see somebody or you're interacting with them in real time, but they're not actually there. What will be the use case of actually talking to someone, whether it's in augmented reality or in virtual reality? What do you think that feels like?
I think the only thing people care about is other people. And when I say I had a conversation with my friend, you don't stop and ask, were they in the same room with you or were they on the phone in California? When I say I read a book, you no longer ask whether I read it on paper or they read it on an e-reader. Nobody cares. So I think once any technology gets to the point where it serves our purpose in communicating with each other, it falls away and we forget about it. And that's a sign of successful technology. It's not a question of whether. It is, as you pointed out, a question of when.
So what do you think that like, if someone's in virtual reality, and these terminologies won't be used in the future, but if someone's in virtual reality communicating with their friends, like what will their face look like?
Well, okay, so let's say that we went back to 1812 and we're talking to Jane Austen,
okay.
And I'm talking about the idea of talking to someone on a telephone,
yeah.
And let's say Jane Austen is a technologist, okay. So she's like, okay, so I understand you have these future words, avatar. So there's this invisible avatar that's transmitted through some electronic means of communication, and you're talking to an invisible person, but it's not really them, it's some representation of them. Well, we don't think about that, we just talk to our friend. And we don't even think about the fact that we don't see them because it's a successful technology. So my point is that whatever works, works. And we're going to privilege psychological communication over whatever are the particulars of the means that get us there, whatever it is. We'll know when it's successful because we'll stop talking about it.
We'll use avatars for a while. So I think that'll be the case because volumetric, so capturing a real person in 3D is really hard today. There are a couple companies that are working on it, but in effect to create a real life reality capture of a human being, you need to kind of reconstruct a 3D model of who they are. And that's pretty challenging today because you need to capture a lot of light data and so forth. And those cameras are not really gonna be democratized for some time. And so you know, I'm of the opinion that we're gonna be using avatars to kind of help with that for some time. And that'll be a bit of a challenge for true presence.
I think it's going to be something like in Ready Player One, where you're creating avatars that are the what you want yourself to be, because you yourself are physical on Earth, but now in this VR space, you have the opportunity to create this character that may be, in your opinion, a better version of yourself.
I'm reminded often whenever talking about like shared presence and what does the foreigner feel like. One device that did it really well and I don't think needs any improvement in the future, it was this simple thing created by Hiroshi Ishii, made of three rollers, yeah, wooden rollers. You would roll them on one hand, on one side of like the communicating device, on the other side they would roll according to the person's hand. It's very, very low tech, but it's very high fidelity. And you actually feel, if you close your eyes, you feel the person there. And I really think, like, you know, like if we take those baby steps, we create a subset of feeling presence that with our imagination can complete what presence is. And again, it's not about rendering. It's just about, you know, clever hacks of the mind and putting yourself there. In that sense, you know, it's just about creating the good product. So I'm less concerned with what we actually look like and how what we do insofar to capture the looking like. I'm more interested, you know, like if once we build the right tech, what is the gestalt of our feelings act like?
Yeah, I think this is probably an important idea. So for a while, the internet was supposed to be this thing that enabled full telepresence. We could work from anywhere, and real estate wouldn't matter anymore. Yet, you know, Silicon Valley is incredibly powerful. We have a cluster of cities, or everybody's moving to the city. So New York is an incredibly powerful place to be. And you know, it'll be interesting. I think VR and AR do have a chance to change that a bit. So with avatars, to be able to go into a meeting, even if you're not your full self, and to be able to have go on a whiteboard or you know be on a conference call, even if that's not exciting, you know, these are some of the things that people actually do every day to get work done. That's actually something that I do think will be very possible within 10 years. And I think that could change the way people work and the way people think about space and where they need to live.
Although it may not be in opposition, as the internet use has risen, airplane travel has also risen. So it could be that as people have a richer sense of, oh, I really know and care about more people, they actually then want to be in the same place as those people. So it may not be a zero-sum game.
True.
Yeah, and I don't actually think the communication, the behavior is going to change that much based on what we're already doing today. So like if you think about it in the Skype context, that's one thing, but think about all the conference calls that happen between 13-year-olds playing Call of Duty. You know, they're like running around with avatars, killing each other, having a conference call, you know, talking about each other's mom. And so that's like going to continue.
I can't believe you're on that call.
Yeah. And so I don't think that changes a whole lot in VR and AR 10 or 15 years from now. It's just, it changes how we look. But if you think about it, like we already have fully rendered high-res soldiers running around that look really great, and that's like a 13-year-old kid, you know? Like we have great avatars. The only difference is that you're taking the television that's in your room and miniaturizing it, sticking it on your face. That's the difference. Like, and eventually down the road, you have a pass through, and you know you're seeing things play out in front of you and on your coffee table. But it's the same thing. You're having a conversation with your friends or with your coworkers, and you're seeing things play out in front of you. You don't see a lot of times, and we never really saw this manifest. You only see it in B2B communications, where you have a video conference and it's one or two or three or four people, and they want to see each other eye to eye. Face-to-face. And that type of communication, I mean, we've been talking about this for 20 years and trying to change that and make it different and make it more virtual and more immersive, and it stayed that way. And the things that have gotten more immersive have gotten to the point of, you know, you're sitting in the living room playing games with your friends and communicating with your avatars running around playing games. And so that's human behavior, and, you know, the point was already made that that's one of the hardest things to change is human behavior, and it's evolved, and that's how we interact with technology. So as you see VR and AR evolve over the next 5 to 10 years, a lot of those dynamics and forces will stay in play because that behavior is hard to change.
Yeah. So stemming from the point that you made about 13-year-old boys controlling soldiers, so right now when they collide with other soldiers, they really don't feel it, or if they collide with something, they really don't feel it. But in virtual reality and augmented reality, if you were to collide with something, you would feel that. I don't know if for those of you who've been in a virtual reality headset, something's too close to you, you start to feel like little like anxious, and you're like, okay, this thing needs to go away from me. So what do you think needs to evolve in terms of personal space in these virtual and augmented reality worlds? Like what rules are going to be defined? Or if you have any ideas around the topic, I'd love to hear
that. I sort of go with your basic thesis, which is people don't change at all. I mean, the other night I saw, you know, for the nth time, Shakespeare play Much Ado About Nothing. It's all the same. You know, that was 400 years ago, and everybody's the same as they were 400 years ago, except they have little screens in their pockets. I do think that there are some, I mean, we don't change at all, but the way we express our communication with each other physically does seem to evolve when we're able to. For example, there was a time about 20 years ago when for the first time you could have a phone conversation with somebody and you're both looking at data online. You know, sometime in the 90s, you could have, oh, I'm really smart because I just looked that thing up while I was talking to you. And we still haven't gotten to the, and now a lot of people who just grew up in that world and take that for granted, like we could always do that. But you couldn't do that in the 80s, but you could do that in the 90s. And we still haven't gotten to a particular transition, speaking of the contact lenses or glasses, where if I'm having a face-to-face conversation with you and I want to look something up, I have to take this brick out of my pocket, look at it, and socially break our contract. But there'll come a point when we can be having this conversation and the information is there. Like 20 years ago, it started happening with phone conversations. We're not going to change, but we're going to have these conveniences, and then we're going to adapt social practices around those conveniences in our social and work interactions with each other.
So I think there are some things that I hope will change. So in terms of kind of you being able to be in someone's private space and feel differently inside a virtual reality experience, I think it's important for product designers to think about that. So I'll give you guys an example. So a couple years ago, Facebook ran a study where they manipulated, they ran this study where they manipulated the sentiment of statuses in people's news feeds and could show that they would make them sadder. So this was controversial. There were some of you might have seen this. That's something that we're having to deal with now, the fact that product designers can affect how people feel fundamentally and if changes their mood throughout the day. And so I think in VR, that's even more important. I think empathy is even more important in virtual reality when you're controlling a person's entire virtual existence. Having some empathy for your users, I think, will be paramount, and hope people think about that in a big way.
And I think that
We're talking about personal space. Pretty much a rule of thumb for me, especially like working in media, is that if you are looking attentively at something, someone is figuring out a way to put an ad there. Pretty much every object, right? So if we have technology to project into your eyes at a reasonable distance, someone will put ads there, and someone will put ads there in the street. And someone will track that, and this is an invasion of personal space that starts from a commercial. Advertising is relatively benign compared to the other things that can be put there. If we as responsible designers want to think about this problem and how it shapes out, how we want to build the future so it's not completely terrible, we have to consider what. How people want to address this, what people want to allow there. And I think the biggest thing in putting pixels in your eyes technologies is a way to form consent around your personal space, right? So I'll start with a simple case, which is VR. You're purely in VR. Someone will figure out a way that you can navigate between websites by walking. It will invariably first look like a Neal Stephenson book, and that's a terrible idea. Right? And it will then evolve to something else, and a website will show up in front of you, and you will encounter a virus, and the virus will be there, and it will invade your personal space and get really close to you, and we want to find a way to stop that. So creating boundaries, like personal space, like 2 meters away from me and you can't come any closer, is a really important thing. We can extrapolate that to actual, real space where, not projecting into your eyes should be a law, pretty much, which is not currently. And then we can start layering the things that Twitter is currently struggling with in terms of harassment can actually still show up when people are miles away from you. There's a lot to think about in that space. I'm going to skip some of these for the briefness of time.
So stemming from what you were saying, what then are these two things that you're most worried about? And if so, I'd love to hear more about the things you're worried about, and from the rest of the panelists, what you're most worried about in the future of VR and AR.
I mean, I think the other thing is that is really worrying to me is the inequality that's going to be evolving from, you can look at any tech and say the same, right? People who don't have access to water, are being excluded by a very serious way, and then people who don't have access to clean water, that's another tier, same thing. We have the inequality there, and when people have start using VR and can have social mobility because normally they go to places that they can't go in real life, people who don't have VR will be excluded from that. That's going to be a real problem. Privacy is the second problem of that, and the other one, I'm sorry, I wrote this down. Yeah, and like I think the divergence of objective reality there is really significant. The fact that like you said, you know, Facebook manipulated our feeds to make people feel differently. I feel that, you know, like in this coming election, that's very, very visible in our filter bubbles, and we do see reality in a different way. And like, yeah, some grounding. I won't say like a complete level of grounding is necessary, obviously not, but some of it is.
It would be nice to see in the 5 to 10 year timeline here that we are in, how acceptance of human interaction is changed. Right now, video chatting in the business world is still awkward at most companies, and face-to-face interaction at a table is how deals are done. And human interaction is very, very important, and it is very curious to see how, when the technology improves, whether it's avatars or some sort of physical exact representation of all of us, and we can do this in headset, I look forward to that time. I think that's going to change an awful lot. But right now, we are far away from that. But I'm curious, it's more of a question, it's just a personal curiosity. What's going to be required to make that happen?
I think there's something very specifically that will never change because they're not about technology. If you and I are making an important business deal, there could be a perfect representation of you in every way in front of me and vice versa. But if I get on an airplane and I go vote with my one unique body in the world and put it at risk and get to that table and sit there, you're going to trust me a lot more. So that's not even about technology. That's about something else. And I don't think any of this stuff will affect that.
Well, because in some of the earlier conversations that have been had out in the zeitgeist, either it was Lucky Palmer or it was Zuckerberg who said something about business deals are going to happen now in VR. And I doubt that for a very long time because the body language and the sitting across the table from each other and getting on the plane is still so much important.
But I think you're saying that'll still be the case no matter what the technology occurs.
Yeah, I think Mark Zuckerberg is more likely to fund your company if you actually show up there.
Right. Yeah. So, Ken, I would love to hear the things that you're worried about in the future of VR and AR.
Oh, okay. So, yeah, I think we as humans have a tendency to not think about things we don't see. I mean, you know, we don't think about what brought that chicken to our plate that we're eating. You know, and we don't think about where our clothes came from unless somebody makes us think about it. There are a lot of things we don't think about. If you eat at a restaurant, I mean, really, when was the last time you had a great meal at a restaurant and you said, I demand to be taken to the kitchen to see how this was prepared? I mean, probably never. So that's going to be easier and easier with a lot more things. You can be walking down the street sometime in that 5, 10, 15 years or maybe 20 years and, you know, there's no paint on that building, and there's a homeless person in the corner, blah, blah, blah. You don't see them. You don't need to see them. You're seeing Mark Zuckerberg's ads instead. So this has always been a danger because people are really good at tuning out what they don't want to see, and I think that technology won't solve the problem. Technology won't create the problem. I think a kind of an aware citizenry is the only thing that can ever deal with that kind of stuff. It's just there's going to be more stuff for us to deal with.
Yeah, and I mean, I'll kind of add to that. It kind of dovetails off of it, but I mean, humans are pretty fucking lazy, honestly. And as we build technology, like who's been to the library in the last 2 weeks? All right, 3 people. Come on. Yeah, because you can sit at your computer and barely move your hands and find every article ever written. And that's like our quest for laziness. Like, how crazy is that? We want to spend as little energy as possible getting as much done as we possibly can. And if you think about technologies that enable laziness and what that's going to do for us, like a real fear is that we're going to get into VR and AR and have everything we need right at our fingertips, right in our house, and turn into, you know, a pile of goo and never go anywhere and have everything at our fingertips. And we can already, you know, take drugs to feel exactly how we want to feel. I'm feeling too anxious, Xanax. I'm feeling down, drink some coffee. Like, you can almost manipulate everything in every way, your eyes and your ears and your feelings and emotions, and you have every bit of information at your fingertips, and you can have video conferences, you can play video games with your friends. Like, why leave? Why leave the house? And so, like, we, you know, Pokemon Go is a good thing to get people going outside. So, like, hopefully we get more of that. Like, hopefully we can get more of the technology and, like, but my biggest fear is that we as lazy ass humans are going to use this technology to stop interacting with each other for real.
So you're afraid of being lazy, being super lazy, basically, is what right. I'm hearing. Is there anything that you're
like the people at the end of Wall-E, you know, when you finally see the humans,
they're all like fat.
And they're floating
gross.
Around.
Are well, you?
At the end, it's like Ready Player One. At the end, they kind of wake up. Yeah.
Elon Musk actually said something pretty interesting about like his view of what it's going to be to have an output device that's connected to your brain seamlessly, and you can output at speeds that are much higher than using a keyboard. And, you know, like, I would say that, like, the laziness, I mean, there's all kinds of lazy. There's, like, the programmer lazy. That's a good kind of lazy, right? It's like, I want to get more stuff done with less. And I think that may actually be a way to, you know, to, like, optimize for our pure neural output. And surely we're going to change, but we're tool makers. Like, we need to find a way to change in a way that, like, that betters the man.
Yeah, I want to expand on what Omer just said. It's we are lazy, but we're also the opposite. We are problem solvers, and we get a lot of pleasure out of solving problems. You know, there's an old saying that we don't take care of our children because we love them. We love them because we take care of them. And I think we're like that with a lot of things. People who discover cooking, who discover making music with a musical instrument, realize it's a lot more fun than not doing it. And I think we always have the capability of going with the active, creative part of ourselves. And technology doesn't force us into either the lazy route or the active route. It just gives us more options for choosing that in different ways.
Do you think that everyone in like 15 years will have to be technical in some sort? Because if they don't know how to program, they don't know how to build things or tinker in this way, then they can't innovate on top of technology?
I used to think so, and I changed my mind. Because I used to think, oh, we have to teach all kids to program. And then I started, I had a lot of conversation with people, and I thought, well, if it's part of communication with other people, people will learn it. So a lot of people learn to play the piano, but you know, we all sit in chairs, but only a small percentage of us actually become carpenters. So I think a lot of the infrastructure will continue to be specialized if it's not about our communication with the people that we communicate with every day. But the parts of things that are programming like that's about me communicating with you, people are going to be interested in that.
And like we're also, you know, it's like if you take it one step back, like not just everyone needs to know how to program, but we all make tools all the time. We all make abstractions. Like Tilt Brush. How many people play with Tilt Brush in this room? That's a lot. Tilt Brush. There was no easy way to draw in 3D before that in VR. And Tilt Brush came along, and all of a sudden that was a tool that happened. You know, and like we can use that to make things, and which serve as abstractions. And you know, we don't necessarily need to program everything in our world, but that does not stop us from creating, because there are carpenters of this age. There will be carpenters of the digital age that will be using tools, like you know, there are video editors. Like there are many other things that are not involved in the science of creating it, but still know the abstractions. And I think that like that is viable. That is a viable thing that will continue, like a pattern that will continue to be relevant in VR. But we will have to increase our literacy in computer vision, for example, because you know now we have like sort of a sixth sense of what's wrong with the computer. Oh, it's the hard drive being slow because something, or the network is disconnected, so I have to pray to the network gods. Our literacy will increase in that way, and it will come to encapsulate what gesture recognition means, how we sort of like have a folk belief about gesture recognition. that may well reflect how it really works, but it doesn't matter because that's the common knowledge. So that will increase. I don't really think that everyone will need to program, unfortunately.
So I think a lot of folks are going to be programming and not realizing that they're necessarily programming. So for example, if you watch Louis C.K. on Netflix, and suddenly Netflix updates its algorithms, in a way, you can kind of, in an abstract way, you can kind of think of that as programming. So if you state any kind of, you give a Facebook a like, you start curating your newsfeed, and you tell Gmail that, you know, this, whatever I got from this guy was spam. Just kidding.
It could be.
You'll start curating what you get in your email. So I think all of us will start programming in a very abstract way, and already kind of are. And it might be important for folks to understand computer science in the way that you might want to read classic literature or things like that. So there are good reasons to teach people how to program in certain ways, but I don't believe that everybody will need to code in the understanding JavaScript sense of the word.
Yeah, I think that my audience is, and not just at Framestore, but just personally, I look at my audience as mass, as everyone, not just academics. I'm not an academic, but I think it's, everyone might not be a programmer, but everyone's going to become hopefully familiar with all of these tools and apps and using all of this stuff and not be afraid. And we see the adoption, obviously, of all these apps and everything is so great. People are now going to grow up with the concept of I'm sharing, I'm using these apps, I'm going to download a new app when I get it. I think we're in a space now where adoption is so much quicker. And I think that's, for me, what it's more about. There's the likelihood is higher that people are going to adopt your technology because that, I think that fear is gone. I think generations prior, there was always a fear of, oh, this is too complicated, I don't know how to do this. But now, as you said, there are these beliefs and these folk ideas of how some stuff works, but that's true to a degree. I think people are now so much more comfortable than they were 10 years ago. And then 10 years from now, I mean, it's going to be quite amazing.
Cool. So I read this book called Feed by MT Anderson, and in this world that the author depicts, everyone is born and then they get a chip in their bodies, and then everyone lives with like AR and VR, and if you don't get a chip from really early on, then you're kind of weird. So I wanted to hear from all the panelists whether or not they think that in 10, 15 years, 20 years, whether or not people will be born and have a chip in their bodies or contacts or whatever it is, or to something like you actually have to have a bit of a childhood before you get a device.
How do you know we don't have the chip now?
We don't. We don't. All
right. Just checking. Okay. Ow. I actually think that it's not so much, it's not so important whether it's how it's done. I mean, yes, there's everybody in this room probably has a $600 brick in their pocket. And it's not so important that you do, except for the people who sell them to you in their industry. To you, what's important is that you now have different ways of communicating with people. So I think the more important question is not what the physical substrate will be. I mean, kids aren't born learning how to read and write. At some particular point, we teach them to read and write, but not before a certain age. So I think those things will just work themselves out. I think what's actually more important is what will happen, forgetting about things like programming or things that are equivalent to carpentry. I mean, we're having a face-to-face conversation and stuff is floating in the air between us. What does it mean? What does it mean for how we communicate? We may want the kids to have the technology sooner because we may want stuff that they're good at. Kids are really good at learning language. They're much better than we are. So we might want to have kids who are younger than 7 years old able to draw in the air and then create meaning that way. And it'll give them a leg up in society to have that kind of literacy, a future literacy that we can't even really talk about yet because we don't live in a world where it's possible. And I'm a sort of a hopeful person. I think it's not so much the dangers, it's more the possibilities that we sort of want to focus on creating in the world.
I think there's going to be a lot of pushback from having the chip in your hand. But if you had to have the chip or some sort of identification, I think it's not too much different from where we are right now with everybody having a brick in their pocket. We already have that I think that paradigm, that behavior in our life. Does it make your life easier? Can you pay for things easier? Is there some sort of benefit to you having that chip in your hand? Or is it a means to control your life for the government to track you, or some sort of Logan's Run type scenario?
Well, actually, they can track you now. We don't
exactly. Exactly. That's a different panel.
I think it's
probably there's always going to be some sort of something, whether it's some sort of physical substrate or a device we carry around that changes our life. I think we're already there, really.
Yeah, I mean, the human brain naturally has this weird obsession. Not only are we super lazy, but we also don't want to get hurt and we don't want to die. And so anything that we can do to augment ourselves and fix ourselves, we want to do. I mean, there's almost nobody I've ever met in the world who thinks that they're perfect. And you know, somebody's not happy with their cheekbones, or, you know, somebody needs to run more. And so as humans, our perfect scenario is that we have this brain sitting inside this perfectly designed body that everything is replaceable and that we never die. Like, we're somehow weirdly trying to work towards that by either solving it with drugs or solving it with replacing things on our body. And so, it's a natural progression to start inserting things into ourselves and making ourselves better. Like, if you can gain advantages as a human over other humans by inserting things into yourself, people will start doing it. And so, eventually you're going to have, you know, this perfect replaceable everything that can, you know, have anything projected in their eyes and feel anything at any given time. And, you know, it's going to be perfectly fine. You're going to come out as a baby. You're going to get things put under your skin right away, and it's not going to be a big deal. And, you know, it's less about is it acceptable in society today? It's where our brains are naturally taking us in the future. And that's what we're trying to do, cure death and make ourselves better all the time.
And also the notion of a chip kind of mystifies me, because could it really be one chip that solves everything? The first thing I say, when I see a chip like that, I'm like, I want to customize that chip.
Add some RAM to it.
No, it's just not even add RAM. I want to add echolocation. I want to be able to see what's going on over there. I want to be able to feel RF. Thank you so much. That's the sort of thing where, you know, if you extrapolate what our desiderata right now of experiencing the real world are, I think they're going to end pretty soon after we are enabled the next sense and go on to something else. And there is no one chip that will extend our minds beyond the capabilities that we're able to think of. And it's also at that point, it's at the hand of artists. At hand of artists to make it better. You have to invent content for that fucking chip. there's no way around that. We will not continue to entertain ourselves just by having more senses.
One thing I've realized just now is that future Omer is going to be very dangerous.
Well, great. So we're running a little bit low on time, and I wanted to ask the audience if they had any questions. Okay, you.
So I have a question. How can technology companies like Google and even Cable can actually help optimize VR and AR? Because as of right now, we have Pokemon Go. And my little brother went through about 20 gigabytes on my data. So how can they actually take advantage and help you guys?
Who's the you guys? 20
gigs. 20 gigs of data, meaning he was burning through your data plan.
Correct.
And you had to pay extra money.
Yes.
Right. I mean, that's just at some point in the great utopia with the chips and the headsets and the avatars, we're going to have also hopefully unlimited data as well. But I think that's a different panel.
Question. Beautiful.
I mean, someone else could also answer that question. I don't know.
I'd love if you guys could kind of talk a little bit about VR's application to the video game industry specifically. So I guess a more focused question we take the last 20 years of development, you know, it's like graphic processing, incorporation of like a communications element. So, you know, looking forward 20 years, do you see VR as just like a pure extension of the video game industry, or is it like a separate timeline completely? And then also just from kind of like a practical market facing, like consumer kind of tangible perspective, like what are the functionalities of like the next popular video game? Like what is the World of Warcraft of VR? Like what will that actually look like?
Well, I see here. I mean, from a consumer marketing standpoint, in the immediate term, it's the next generations of the console boxes that I think will have the headset component. You'll be able to buy them in a kit, and it is all going to come together. That combined with the internet connection, that combined with the powerful NVIDIA graphics processing capabilities, all of the. I think the gaming industry, in my opinion, is one of the areas that will hopefully be pushing this kind of all forward, tip of the spear, kind of pulling everything else along with it, because it's going to drive the adoption.
Yeah, there are two markets always. There's the gamers who pay for content upfront, which makes them very convenient to people who make content. And then there's everybody else who outnumber those gamers by a huge amount who want everything to be free, but they're actually, I think as Omer was alluding to, actually paying for everything by ads. And so, you know, like the people like this, that cute thing like, oh, I'm a customer of Facebook. Of course you're not, you're a product of Facebook. The advertisers are the customers. So one of the things that we've seen with technologies before, this, I mean, the GPUs themselves are a classic case. It's the gamers paid 25 years ago for the transition of GPUs from high-end $30,000, $50,000 boxes to stuff that's cheap and fits and eventually fits in your pocket. And of course, most people, most of the time, who use GPUs now are not playing high-end games. So it's not so much that the gamers are incredibly important because they are the high-paying early adopters, and then they're very demanding, and then Moore's Law means that all the stuff you made for the gamers that they paid all that money for will eventually trickle down to the quote-free, unquote, it's in my pocket, it's inexpensive, and I'm paying for it by looking at Google and Facebook ads economy. So there isn't any one answer, it's a kind of a timeline, and VR and AR, like everything else, goes along that timeline.
I also think there's actually a whole content side as well, just, you know, the producing of the content and the 360 content and who's going to be looking at that in browser and who's going to be looking at that in some sort of a headset. Because now everyone's shooting 360, there's this camera right down in here, and it's a growing network there as well, which is separate from the whole gaming community.
Yeah, so I wanted to inquire about either the technical or social restraints of you know, games that are indifferent from reality, that we wouldn't see any pixel difference. Like, what are the bottlenecks, and when do you think we'll get there?
You know, in 1995, people would play these three... By the way, I love your T-shirt. It's a fantastic T-shirt. It says, I have seen the future. And I'm going to ask him afterwards, think what he saw there. In 1995, this is a thing they do every once in a while at the Game Developers Conference. They show, hey, in 1995, everyone said, this game is indistinguishable from reality, and now we look at it, it's all big blocky pixels and terrible lighting, and it's horrible, and it's five polygons. And then they said, that in 2000, and then they said that in 2003, and everybody really believed it. So I think we're all going to convince ourselves in any given year that the games we're looking at are indistinguishable from reality, and then everybody 5 years later is going to be very embarrassed that they said that. So reality is amazing, and people's eyes and brains and the amount of information we can get is amazing. So I think that in any given time, people are going to really believe they're seeing reality, but that's going to happen. That general consensus is going to happen many years before it's literally true, but it may not matter whether it's literally true. What'll matter is that people have that feeling.
And like one more thing I'd like to add to Ken is that you know, we keep talking about like rendering being that important, and what I find surprising about game designers is how well they can, with very, very simple storytelling tools, immerse you in something. And I think that, like, you know, I work in a company that profits from graphics cards, but like everyone there is also concerned about how compelling the story is and how good the gameplay is. And I think that matters significantly more because, you know, the rendering details can be improved. A terrible story can't.
So we have to wrap up, but let's give a big round of applause to our panelists.